Well, good morning, everyone, and welcome to the service. My name is Jim Ayers, and I'm a professor at Lancaster Bible College. Have had the privilege of serving there for 27 years, and I want to thank all of you who are watching the service this morning online, and we are all very much aware of things that are happening in our nation, and the challenges of travel. And so I thought this morning it might be fun for us to actually take a trip. But we're going to take a biblical journey in a passage of Scripture in Luke chapter 19. And we're going to visit a biblical city and one of the most famous events in the Bible that that occurred there. So if you're following along in your Bible this morning, I would invite you to make your way to Luke chapter 19 as we return this morning, at least in our mind's eye, to the city of Jericho. Now, I'd like to take a few moments before we read the passage, and we'll pray together. Take a few moments to just talk to you about the city of Jericho so that we have a bit of context and a bit of understanding about this location where this famous event and conversation occurred. This was a city that Jesus passed through many times on his way from the northern part of Israel around the Sea of Galilee to the central part of Israel to the city of Jerusalem. Now, in those days, as is the case today, it's about a 100-mile trip from the northern tip of the Sea of Galilee, from the city of Capernaum, to the city of Jericho. And so you would travel south following the Jordan River for about 80 miles, and then people would find themselves in the city of Jericho. And it was a convenient place for individuals who were making the trek, the journey, the pilgrimage, whatever you want to refer to it as, a convenient place for them to rest before they made the last leg of the journey to travel into Jerusalem. Now, the map that I have in front of you would suggest, and you can see visually, where the city of Jericho is located in retrospect to the where the Dead Sea is in the central part of Israel as we know it today. It was a beautiful oasis. I have just a couple of pictures that are current pictures of the city of Jericho. I've had the incredible privilege of being to the land of Israel 18 times and have seen this city and this scenery quite often, but it's a very beautiful area. You can see that it's an agricultural area. It was in ancient times, and it continues to be today. In the day of Jesus, it was a beautiful oasis, and anyone who was following the law of Moses would travel to Jerusalem, make a pilgrimage there three times a year for major festivals, which they would celebrate in the city. And so on this particular occasion, Jesus was making that journey, and the interesting thing was that it was the last week of Jesus' life. And so this is the last time that he is going to be making the journey from Jericho, through Jericho, to Jerusalem. And on this particular day, he finds himself in the city of Jericho, and he is surrounded by a desert area as he is exiting the city, as we'll read in a very, very short time, on the Roman road that leads from Jericho to Jerusalem. Now, that was about a 16 or 17 mile journey. This is a picture, a couple of pictures of both the ancient Roman road and the remains of the Roman road as it can be seen today, and also some other archaeological sites that are in the area. A picture of Herod's winter palace, which Jesus would have walked right past as well, and some of the other archaeological sites in that particular area. Now, the passage, as we are going to see it unfold in just a few minutes, explains for us that this was a site which was the home for many of the off-duty temple priests and Levites. And this was an upper-class city in the time of Jesus. The people who lived there would have been the off-duty temple priests and the Levites. And the archaeology of the day has revealed lots of things about the city, that they had a synagogue of their own. They had expensive villas that were fairly large. They had ritual baths. They had a hippodrome for chariot and horse races as well, a theater. And so it had all of the trappings of an upper middle class city. And the people who lived there would have been more wealthy than the average Israelite of the day. And so this was Jesus' last visit, as I said, to the city of Jericho as he made his way to Jerusalem for the last time about a week before he is going to be crucified. Now, in the passage that we're going to read together in Luke chapter 19, the context here is that a crowd was already gathered as Jesus is entering the town. And his reputation had preceded him, and he was famous, and everyone knew that a famous man was about to enter the city. And as we read this portion of Scripture, I want us to focus on a single big idea that is going to emerge as we try to paint a portrait of Zacchaeus, the key individual other than Jesus who we find in this passage. So I'd like to read the passage together, but be listening for this key idea, that authentic righteousness is what God desires. And we're going to see if we can spot that in some unique ways in the passage. Luke chapter 19, verses 1 to 10. And I'm reading this morning from the English Standard Version. He, that is Jesus, entered Jericho and was passing through. And there was a man named Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector and was rich. And he was seeking, to see who Jesus was. But on account of the crowd, he could not because he was small of stature. So he ran on ahead and he climbed up into a sycamore tree to see, for he was about to pass that way. And when Jesus came to the place, he looked up and he said to him, Zacchaeus, hurry and come down, for I must stay at your house today. And so he hurried and he came down and he received him joyfully. And when they saw it, they grumbled. He is gone to be the guest of a man who is a sinner. And Zacchaeus stood and he said to the Lord, Behold, Lord, the half of my goods I give to the poor. And if I have defrauded anyone of anything, I restore it fourfold. And Jesus said to him, Today salvation has come to this house, since he also was a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost. Now, would you pause with me for just a moment as we pray together, and then we're going to begin to build a portrait and create a portrait from this passage of this man who we think we know so well, a man called Zacchaeus. So pray with me, please. Father God, thank you this morning for the opportunity. Even though we are distanced from one another, it is good for us to join together in our study of the Word of God, to take a look at a key figure that we have heard the story of many times. And we pray this morning that we would be able to see and to identify how authentic righteousness is truly what you desire to see in our lives. And we pray that that would emerge from what we learn about this man named Zacchaeus. Bless our time together in the Word. Grant us wisdom from above in how to apply it. And Father, we also pray that even though we are distanced, that you would find us faithful in being able to minister and to engage with those in our church family with whom we are able. And we ask this in the bold name of our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Now, I want to first begin by helping you understand that one of the things that is so unusual as we jump into this passage is we have to stop and just define what the name Zacchaeus actually means. Now, I suspect that some of you would be surprised, and even I myself found it ironic when I looked up what his name really meant. And the name Zacchaeus means pure, innocent, or righteous. But I assure you that that was the last thing that people thought of when they heard the name Zacchaeus. But a thought occurred to me as I was thinking about the fact that, you know, I've been hearing the name Zacchaeus ever since I was a little boy going to church and hearing the Sunday school stories. And immediately when I hear the name Zacchaeus, I know the little song that we sang in Sunday school about Zacchaeus being a wee little man. But what strikes me is that I don't know anything at all about Zacchaeus, but by what I learned in that little Sunday school song, Zacchaeus had a reputation, that an impression that I have of him. And you know, what struck me was that's true for every single one of us. That at the mere mention of a person's name, that there is a reputation attached to that. Now, it may be someone who you've never met in your life, that you only know them, you've heard their name, you've watched them from a distance, you've heard about them, you've read about them. but you've never met them, and nonetheless, there is a reputation that follows the name of a person. And I'm going to ask you kindly this morning to try to be cognizant of that and put that aside as we take a look for what the scriptures have to tell us about who Zacchaeus truly is, as opposed to who we have always thought that he was. Just a thought for us to tag from this morning's message is that in reality, every single one of us who are listening to this message, every single one of us who read this passage are reminded that we have a reputation, that when someone hears our name, there's immediately a thought, an impression, an idea, a memory, an experience that is attached to that name. Well, what in fact, when we hear the name Zacchaeus, what is factual based on the scripture? Well, I'm just going to begin to try to paint a picture, a portrait of who Zacchaeus is according to the scriptures. And the thing that jumps out that we know the most about him, if you have been a churchgoer a good portion of your life and have read this passage, is number one, that Zacchaeus was identified here in this passage as the chief tax collector. Now, again, it's important that we just take a moment and go back to the location of Jericho. If you recall from the map, it was very close to the city of Jerusalem, just 16 to 17 miles outside of the city of Jerusalem. But what we didn't see on that map was that Jericho sits squarely on the middle of a crossroads of commerce from those who were traveling north and south and those who were traveling east and west. There were taxes to pay to Rome, and so the Romans had strategically set up tax locations for all of the things that were imported and exported from the Mediterranean, either that were going to the ocean to be shipped elsewhere or that were being brought in from the Mediterranean and being dispersed in the interior of the land. And so the Romans had this process of selecting tax collectors. And although the text doesn't tell us this specifically, we know from history about Roman culture that when we see this little word, the chief tax collector, that gives us a hint that Zacchaeus was not the average tax collector who just simply lived in the community and tried to collect taxes from the people who lived there. The chief tax collector would be more of a tax commissioner. In other words, he was the head honcho over all the other tax collectors who worked under him in the region of Judea. Now, what's even more interesting to me is how they determined who the chief tax collector was. And this is something that for those of us who live in Lancaster County, we can identify with this very, very easily. The Romans actually auctioned off the right to be the chief tax collector to the highest bidder. Now, you can't go anywhere in Lancaster County without seeing signs for an auction house or a house that is being auctioned or an auction that is being held for some kind of equipment or household goods or all kinds of different things. But to think that 2,000 years ago, the Romans used this same system of auctioning off to the highest bidder the right to become the tax collector for a region is very, very unusual. And so we know that Zacchaeus, as the chief tax collector, won that bid. Now, tax collectors did not have very good reputations. This whole system was known as tax farming in some of the historical literature. But because Jews were working for the Romans, they were viewed by their peers, the rest of the Jews in the country, as traitors. as thieves. And there's no doubt, no question about it, that many times some of the tax collectors used strong-arm tactics and threats and intimidation, and they had some unscrupulous practices, and they were abusive, and even would go so far as to say that tax collectors were not welcome to worship in the temple at the time of Jesus. And so of these tax collectors, Zacchaeus was the chief. Now remember where he's living. He's living in the city of Jericho. Do you remember who I mentioned lived primarily in the city of Jericho? The chief priests and the Levites. Those who were not on service doing their temple duty had their homes and their families that resided in the city of Jericho. So here's Jesus entering the city of Jericho, and he comes face to face with the chief tax collector, who is a Jewish man, but he is gathering taxes for the Romans. Now, secondly, we're told in verse 2 that he's rich. Well, he had to be rich if he was able to win that bid from the Romans to become the chief of tax collectors for the region. It's no surprise to us that he was a wealthy man, but the scriptures don't tell us how he acquired that wealth. So secondly, we know not only was he a chief tax collector, but we also know that he was also a rich man. Now here are three more things that we learn about him. And here things begin to get a little bit more interesting. The third thing that's mentioned in verse 3 is that he was small of stature, as it is mentioned in the ESV. In the New American Standard, it said he was small in stature. If you're using an NIV and looking at that, it actually says that he was short. And again, our Sunday school song has programmed us to believe that Zacchaeus was a what? A wee little man. A wee little man was he. Now, so we always equate Zacchaeus with being a short guy. However, if we do our homework, we understand that in the pages of Scripture, this was only one interpretation of what it had to do with a person's stature. Certainly, how tall they were was one aspect of stature. A second aspect of stature had to do with their age. And in some portions of Scripture where this exact same word is used, it is referring to the age of an individual. And thirdly, the third thing that we find is that it is also referencing a person's social status. In other words, what kind of stature did they have in the community? Were they an influential person? So we have three different options, three different ways in which we can interpret the fact that he was small of stature. Does it truly mean that he was short? Or does it mean that he was a young man, or does it mean that he was not looked on highly in the community? Well, understanding the context of Jericho and being despised as he was, I honestly lean toward believing that the crowd did not respect him enough to allow him to get a front row seat. Remember what it says in verse 3? Listen to it again. On account of the crowd, he could not. Now, he was trying to see Jesus. And it says the reason that he could not was because he was small stature. Could I suggest to you an alternative to the version or conclusion that he was just short and he could not see over everyone? Is it possible, or is it even probable, that he was so low of stature because of his job living in Jericho that no one in the town welcomed him or no one was going to do Zacchaeus a favor by allowing him a front row seat to be able to see this famous man named Jesus who was passing through Jericho. And so even though he pressed against the crowd and he tried to get to the front, just like everyone else does at a parade, trying to get a front row seat, you know what we do in Lancaster County? We get our lawn chairs out on the parade route because we want to be right in front so that we can see better than anybody else. Is it possible that that's what was happening to Zacchaeus? In other words, that he was blocked out by the pious priests and Levites because he did not have the social status in Jericho that he did? Well, he didn't just try once. The verb that is used there suggests that he was repeatedly making attempts to try to get in front of the crowd to see Jesus. And that's where the fourth quality, fourth point comes in, that he was a resourceful man. And we simply see that in verse 4, where it says that he ran on ahead and he climbed up into a sycamore tree to see him. Now, if you've never seen a sycamore tree, let me just describe one to you very quickly. They're rather short trees, not tall like an oak or a maple, but they're shorter trees, but they have very long lateral branches. And it speaks really to what Zacchaeus was doing, because Zacchaeus was thinking ahead, knowing which way Jesus was going as he passed through the town, anticipating that Jesus would exit the town on the same Roman road. And so Zacchaeus strategically climbs up in this sycamore tree, according to the song's words, for the Lord he wanted to see. Could I suggest to you that maybe Zacchaeus just knew which way the parade was going? And so he runs out ahead, climbs up in the sycamore tree, knowing that Jesus is going to pass by and that he would get a very good look at Jesus. Well, we also know from verses 5 and 6 that he was hospitable. Now, when Jesus gets to the sycamore tree, Jesus stops. Now, Jesus has not said a word to anyone as he has been in the town. There, at least nothing is recorded for us in Scripture. But he gets to the tree and he stops and he says this in verses 5 and 6. He said, Zacchaeus, hurry and come down. I must stay at your house today. And it says that he came down at once and he received him joyfully or gladly. I have to smile when I read this because Jesus invited himself over to Zacchaeus' house. It's the only time that I know of in the Gospels when Jesus invited himself to come to someone's house. Usually he was invited by others. But Jesus insists and says, Zac, I must come to your house. And I believe that Jesus had a point to make because of the emphatic way in which it says, I must. It meant that Jesus was saying, this is something that I must do. It is necessary for me to accomplish the will of God. Well, we also know just a couple of more things, and we're coming down the home stretch here very quickly. We also know how disrespected that Zacchaeus was. And when those who were in the crowd watched this, they said that Zacchaeus was a sinner. What did they say in verse 7? When they saw it, they grumbled, he has gone to be the guest of a sinner. Now, again, I find that interesting. Does that mean that they did not see themselves as sinners? That Zacchaeus was the only one in the crowd who was a sinner? And how quickly it is easy for us to forget in our own self-righteousness on occasion that sometimes we judge sin on a sliding scale thinking that someone else's sin is worse than our own. But clearly, he was disrespected. I want you to notice also that he was a very generous man in verse 8. He said, "Look, Lord, here and now I give half of my possessions to the poor." Now let's just pause there for a moment. Jesus didn't ask him to do that. He was not compelled to do that. I would not be so bold as to say this was sacrificial giving. We really don't know how rich he was. We know he was rich. How rich? We don't know. You know, he could have been the Warren Buffett of his day. He could have been the Jeff Bezos, the owner of Amazon of his day. He could have been the Bill Gates of his day. We don't know if his giving was sacrificial. All we know is that he says, "Here and now I give half of my possessions to the poor." Now, by any standard, that's generous. I also believe that he was a man who was honest. In verse 9, he says, "If I have cheated or defrauded anyone out of anything, I will pay it back and restore four times the amount." Now, I want you just to think about that for a moment. We don't have time to turn to the text this morning, but in Leviticus chapter 6, verse 5, verses 1 to 5, it tells us that according to the law of Moses, if someone cheated someone out of something, they had to refund what they owed the person, and then they had to give them an additional 20%. That's not what Zacchaeus does. Zacchaeus says, if there's anyone that I have cheated or defrauded out of anything, I will pay it back. I'll restore to them fourfold the amount. So I'll pay them back what I want, what I owe them, and then I will multiply that by three and return 400%. Now, I want to suggest to you, just think about this for a moment. If Zacchaeus offered four times the amount of money to anyone that he defrauded out of anything, if I was Zacchaeus, I would want to be absolutely sure in my heart of hearts that I knew that I had not defrauded people, that I had not cheated people. I want to propose to you that Zacchaeus was in fact living up to his name as a pure man, a righteous man, a man of integrity. And he may truly have employed other people, other tax collectors who were not people of integrity. But as for Zacchaeus, you don't make a commitment like that. You don't make a promise like that unless you're honest. The last thing that we learn about Zacchaeus is that he was Jewish. So here we have a portrait of Zacchaeus that's quite different from maybe what we have simply assumed about him. But before we bring things to a conclusion this morning, I would like to point us to a couple of principles that we can take away from the life of Zacchaeus and see how he was really striving for liberty and justice for all. And we see these justice principles coming through in this passage, and we'll talk about the liberty principle in just a moment. But let's look at a couple of principles here. Number one, I want you to notice how the ministry model of Jesus was always missional. And I want to define what I mean by that term. In other words, that ministry just flowed through Jesus in the normal course of events. He was very intentional. He was very intentional about taking time for people. But it just flowed naturally. If we were to take the time, and you may do so, just go back one chapter. Chapter 18, you find that as Jesus was approaching Jericho, a blind beggar comes up to Jesus and appeals for healing. His name was Bartimaeus, and Jesus indeed healed him, just as Jesus was passing down the road. on his way into Jericho. So much of our ministry today seems to be programmatic. What I mean by that is that we schedule times that we're doing ministry, and then it's like, okay, we're done with the ministry, and we kind of turn that switch off. Where in the model of Jesus' life, we find that he was very missional, that as he was living his life, he simply looked for opportunities and ways in which he could minister to others. Principle number two, the ministry model of Jesus was also indiscriminate. Now, let's be honest with ourselves. Most of us are more and most likely to minister to people who are like us. But here in this trip to Jerusalem, traveling through Jericho, Jesus comes in contact with a beggar at the intersection. The next intersection is a wealthy tax commissioner. And along the way were the chief priests, the Levites, other priests who lived in the city. But the common denominator here is that as Jesus intersected and connected with all of these different kinds of people, he treated people the same. He did not have one set of standards for the way that he treated some and another set of standards to treat others. And what I find very interesting in this passage is that the only thing that Zacchaeus has in common with the rest of the people who live in the town of Jericho is that literally they both despised each other. The people who lived in Jericho by and large despised Jesus because of what he had just done. They despised Zacchaeus because of his job. And we find that even in all of that, social stature was never an obstacle for Jesus. He interacts with a beggar. He interacts with a tax collector. He interacts with chiefs, with priests and Levites. Jesus looks at every person, and we find it all through the Gospels. He looks at every person all the time, and he simply sees an individual who is created in the image of God, and he simply accepts them for who they are, whatever their stature in life is. A third principle here is that Jesus is always full of surprises. And I love this. Because, before he speaks to anyone in Jericho, he calls out Zacchaeus by name, who is straddling on the branch of a sycamore tree. No one could have expected this. It was unthinkable. It shocked everyone who watched it. The people of high stature were upstaged by a guy who was of low stature. And here Zacchaeus, the chief tax collector, had swallowed his pride enough that a man in a tunic climbed up into a sycamore tree. And then in front of the entire crowd, had to climb down. Jesus never played by the popular rules of society. He was countercultural in that way. Someone said it this way, that Jesus was in the world, but he was not of the world because he was for the world. A fourth principle this morning is just a reminder that we should not think of ourselves more highly than we ought. That comes right from Romans chapter 12, verse 3. But Jesus talked on many different occasions. In fact, the very last verse of the passage that we read, the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost. And we need to simply see people for who they are and not measure them by ourselves. I was drawn to verse 7 when it says that all the people who saw this began to mutter that he has gone to be the guest of a sinner. You see, they thought of themselves more highly than they thought of Zacchaeus. We need a simple reminder today that God does not grade sin on a curve. God is not impressed by our wallets, by our IQ, by our athletic ability, our musical ability, our careers, our fame, our education, our GPA, our resume. All of those things mean absolutely nothing to God. And I say this tongue in cheek, but I think some people have this idea that when they get to heaven, God is going to ask for their autograph. Let's be careful that we do not think more highly than we ought. And finally this morning, the last principle that I'd like to leave with you is how authentic righteousness is confirmed by character and actions. You see, and this is really what God desires. And by these standards, this is exactly what God desires. By these standards, Zacchaeus wins. What a contrast it is to the rich young ruler who loved his status and his wealth. Zacchaeus was willing to give away everything. Zacchaeus generously helped the poor and wanted to balance the books if he was guilty of having cheated anyone. And here, what I see is he's living up to his name, which meant righteous. But he had been stereotyped by the position that he held in his hometown. He was obeying the Roman law. There's no evidence that he had ever exploited anyone, no evidence that he was corrupt. And the irony here is that both he and the religious leaders who lived in Jerusalem both derived their salary from the collection of taxes. They were just from even the same people. People had to pay taxes to the Romans, and for people to go and worship in the temple, they had to pay a temple tax. Zacchaeus was just another Jewish man who was trying to live by kingdom values, and he was employed by an unbelieving group of Roman Gentiles. And today, Jesus says, the reminder, Jesus says, today, salvation has come to this house. That is indeed liberty. So, as we try to be righteous and we try to live an authentic, righteous life, because that is what God requires and desires, could I admonish you this morning to just maybe check your reputation? What is it that people really think about you? If you're a risk taker, go to some of those people who you trust the most and say, hey, what kind of reputation do I have among others? In the church, in my neighborhood, where I work. Secondly, we've got a reminder in this passage that we need to deal with our own sin and allow the Spirit of God to do his job of convicting others of their sin. Not looking at others as being worse sinners than we are. And in this season of the year, what a delight it would be for us to be very intentional about inviting someone to our house who's very different from us. Invite them to come and share a meal with you with the attitude and the mindset that there is always something that you can learn from everyone. And so I'd like to leave that thought with you this morning. Check your reputation at the door to find if you're a friend of sinners. Secondly, deal with your own sin. And thirdly, go out of your way in this season to interact with people who are very unlike you and invite them into your home, into your life, so that you can learn from them. I pray that this was challenging today for you to see Zacchaeus through a different pair of eyes from the Word of God. Thank you for allowing me the invitation to come. I'd like to pray with you and conclude. Thank you, Father God, for just challenging us to think about a familiar passage that we thought we had a very good handle on. And perhaps it's one that we have a lot of lessons, very practical lessons that we can learn that would be important things for us to consider for our own lives. And so we thank you for this opportunity, for this time, and pray that you will bless us as we examine our own lives and own hearts and rejoice in the incarnation as we anticipate celebrating the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ as our Savior for the purpose of saving us from our own sin and granting to us liberty and justice for all. We give you thanks in his name. Amen.
Hark the Christ is